So good morning everybody for on the third day of the COSIC course. So I'm Dave Singulet and today I will talk about wireless security. And you might think wireless security, what is he going to talk about, because it can mean a lot of things. And indeed, wireless security is a very broad domain, so it can be, for example, Android security or mobile security in general. Or sometimes if people talking about wireless security, they're mainly talking about physical layer security, things like shamming, or device RF fingerprinting, or sometimes also things like secure localization, distance bounding, those topics. Also, people are looking at cryptographic protocols of wireless systems, of looking at device pairing, so pairing mobile devices, mobile authentication, and so on and so on. There are many, many, many other topics. Of course, you already see that in 45 minutes, I cannot discuss all these topics, so I will just take a few of these topics that I will discuss in the next 45 minutes. But so just bear in mind that there is a lot more than what I'm saying. So what am I going to talk about? So I will first start with a quite long introduction and explain a few things which are very specific for wireless, some particular attacks, some devices that are typically used in when looking at wireless security. So that's a long introduction, and then I will take one of the wireless technologies, which probably all of you know, and some of you are using, as I see now, Wi-Fi. So I will explain a little bit how Wi-Fi security exactly works, and what's good and not so good about Wi-Fi security. And then depending on the time, I maybe will have a few minutes on other communication standards or not, depending how late it is. So let's start with the introduction. So in general, when you're looking at security, so that's not only for wireless security, you're typically always starting with an attacker model. So that's something in security we like a lot. We first always want to sort of model the attacker. And so that's not different in wireless security. And in general, you typically consider, if you look at the devices an attacker can use, we typically assume that an attacker can use any device he wants. So, but still, if you look in practice, there are some devices which are rather interesting to use in wireless security. One of them, and that's of course the most powerful setting, is an attacker really builds his own device from scratch. So builds his custom hardware or use an FPGA, and he uses this for performing some attacks. And in some experiments, this is used. Although what we also sometimes see is that people just use the mobile device themselves. So let's say you want to study, in the past, you want to study GSM security, you want to study this. So you can just maybe take a mobile phone and just change the firmware of this device. Why is this an interesting thing to do? Because this device already does a lot of things you otherwise have to implement yourself. This device already knows how to communicate to your network. So if you use this device, you automatically have all these properties. And so this is not something I make up myself. So people indeed have used this very simple mobile phone, just changed the firmware of these devices and really used this to perform real life attacks on mobile networks. Another type of devices which is very popular and might come up again on Friday in Lennart's lecture is these devices like a HackRF or in general software defined radio. And this is something you see really a lot in wireless security research. What are these devices? Because you might not know them. So these are devices you can connect to your PC. You can completely program them. And you can say, okay, you have to work on this frequency. You have to use this modulation. So you can program this device how it should act wirelessly, which communication protocols it should use, how on physical layer, what frequency, what modulation, all these things you can program. And then you can use this device in the field to intercept traffic or to send out data yourself. And so this is a very useful tool. It's not so expensive. And that's very useful if you are doing wireless security research or you want to do some things in real life. So that's sort of the different devices. These devices, because we are thinking about wireless, they also have antennas, because otherwise it's difficult to have wireless communication. And again, so we, in general, you can't make any assumptions on the antennas of these devices. So maybe you just use some wires that you you make your antenna yourself, or you may have maybe more some more sophisticated directional antennas. And why I'm saying this, because this doesn't look so interesting, but it's very important to know that since an attacker has full control over his device, he can change he can decide how much power, transmission or receiving power he can use in this device, he can change the antenna, and this can have a very big influence on the system. And this is already an old picture. I think I'm already using this for more than 10, 15 years, this picture, but it's still very relevant. So just to give an example, to make it a bit more concrete. So everybody of you knows Bluetooth, and typically the range of Bluetooth is a few meters, as you probably already experienced yourself. So you might wrongly think, okay, if the range of Bluetooth is just a few meters, it means that if somebody wants to attack my Bluetooth connection, he or she should also be within the range of a few meters. And so that's why I'm showing this picture, and I checked it yesterday. The manual is still online. It's called the Blue Sniper, so you can look on the internet and find the manual how to make this. It's not so expensive. And so let's say for, I think, $100 or something. And so for $100, you can make this device that this user here is carrying. And with this Blue Sniper, you can communicate with Bluetooth devices from more than 1.5 kilometers away. So which is already a lot more than 10 meters or a few meters. And so this is just one example, but there are many more. So that as an attack, so if you're considering wireless security, you have to consider that an attacker can be much further away than you might think. And that's important to know. This brings us automatically to wireless attacks. So in general, in security, there are several types of attacks, like passive attacks, active attacks, crypto attacks, implementation attacks, and so on. But some of these attacks are very specific for wireless or have some specific properties. And so I also want to go through a few of these attacks and explain a few typical things there. So let's first start with some passive attacks. One very specific one for wireless is called RF fingerprinting. And what does this mean? So people have discovered that if you take your wireless device and you look at the physical layer, so the thing that you're really at the waves forms that your device is sending, that these are very specific for one specific device. So because if you take several models, one model, and you take several devices of the same model, even though they are the same model, there will still be, if you really zoom in, very small differences in these devices. Maybe a resistor value that's a bit different, or something that has been placed a little bit different. And so these small, very small differences you can really see if you look at the physical layer signal. So there are some features you can extract that you can really identify, okay, this is not, this is device 1, 2, 3, 4 of this particular brand that's being sending something. And so there are some very specific features. People have looked at which features are more interesting to look at to distinguish between several of these devices. So there are some interesting features you can look at in the frequency or in the time domain. And if you look at these features, you can really identify really single devices with a very high accuracy. I think it was 80-90% accuracy. You can really identify single devices. So even if you have protection on higher layers and you want to do everything to protect privacy, you still have a problem on the physical layer. And it's a very difficult one to solve. If you say, okay, I'm not so interested in identifying very specific devices, but I want to identify if it's a device of a particular brand or a particular model, then you can even achieve accuracies of 99%. It's very easy to do. And so since I think this was discovered first time, I think a bit more than 10 years ago, but since then people have looked at, it was initially done for RFID cards, but then people have also looked at, for example, LoRa and all other types of wireless communication or specific types of wireless devices, and have showed that also for these type of technologies or devices, this fingerprinting is possible. I might skip this. Of course, you know that if you're walking around, that sometimes you can see that there are still some open networks which you can connect to, and people can walk around or drive or even fly around and identify these devices, these networks. That's something you probably know. Then, so if I'm looking at wireless communication, there are some very interesting tools you can use as an attacker or as a security researcher to analyze how these networks work. One very well-known is called Wireshark. And so these tools help you if you just get the communication. These tools already understand most of the protocols, and they can help you instead of really getting the ones and zeros, the bits, this can already really say, okay, this is this specific message that has been sent. And so this is a very useful tool if you are as an attacker or as a researcher, you want to analyze some particular protocols and maybe find some security issues there. So typically this sniffing of networks or listening is typically a first step that you do to learn what's going on, and then in the next step you're going to do probably something more active and start exploiting some security weaknesses. Another one which is very specific for wireless is traffic analysis or location privacy. Because if you look at wireless communication, in the best case your data is encrypted. But then typically your headers, where you have your address information, like who's sending the device or what's the receiver, these are typically not encrypted, because otherwise the other device doesn't know that you're sending something to this device. And so if you're just eavesdropping all the communication and you're looking at these headers, then you can really identify certain devices. And if you don't know where they are and you track them in time, then you can really do something like this, that you know, okay, this device was first over here, then there, and so on. And you can really follow the user. And why I'm saying following the user, because typically as a user, you have some devices which you're always carrying, like a mobile phone or maybe a smartwatch and so on. So if you do this, listening to these headers and to this address information of these devices, you can really track these devices over time and place. And so, of course, you can also do this on other types of devices, but that is particularly interesting in wireless, because then these devices are typically mobile and are carried around. And so this is something that, for sure, you also need to consider in wireless security. So these were all passive attacks, but there are, of course, also active attacks. And there are active attacks that everybody knows, like spoofing, replay, and so on. But there are also a few of them which, again, are very specific to wireless. The first of them is shamming. So let's say that we have two devices over here, your laptop and this was a tablet, and they are sending some data. What you can do as an attacker is just that you send yourself also a signal, sort of noise or something else, and you do it in such a way that the receiver is not receiving the signal from the transmitter anymore. So that the receiver just receives noise or even nothing at all. And so this is in fact very easy to do. You just have to know on which frequencies this device is sending, and if you have enough power, this is very easy to do. And you can completely disturb the communication channel. Of course, what you don't want as an attacker is that you... So in worst case, you could just send this noise or this jamming signal over all frequencies with a lot of power, and then you can jam everything. But as an attacker, you will not do this for two reasons. First of all, it's very expensive, and you will consume a lot of energy. It's very expensive to have a very broad bandwidth and jam all this bandwidth. And secondly, if you're doing this, it's very likely that you will be detected, that somebody will notify, oh, my wireless communication doesn't work anymore, or there's a strong jamming signal, and then they just find you and then make sure that you stop jamming the signal. So that's why, in practice, people are often interested in things like selective shamming, that it's sort of a cat and mouse game. So you want to, as an attacker, you want to spend as little effort as possible, as little energy as possible, but still make sure that the legitimate devices cannot communicate anymore. And just as a very simple idea, how can you do this? If you look at a wireless communication message, it typically looks like this. You have some fields like a start of a frame to say, okay, this is a new frame. You have some preamble to make sure that the other device is synchronized, and then you have your header information and your payload and so on, and then an end of frame. And so as an attacker, if you just jam this first part here, the start of frame, then the other party already doesn't know that there is a frame coming, and you have already jammed this data. So if you only jam this, even if all the rest is sent correctly, the other device will not receive this message correctly, because it didn't see the start of frame. And so this is already maybe a very toy example that shows already that by just jamming a few bits or a small part of your message, you can already jam quite a lot. Another very specific one, and Bart already mentioned it yesterday in his talk with the South African planes and the rocket system. So it's called a relay attack. And I will explain it again, but now for cars. So you have some modern cars, and typically in these modern cars you have a key which you can just carry in your pocket, and if you come close to this car and you attach the door handle, your key will authenticate to the car, will prove that it knows a certain cryptographic key. So it will authenticate to the car, and if this authentication is successful, the car will open. And so this fancy sports car that has this system. So if the key is close by, they start communicating automatically, and if authentication is successful, you can drive away with the car. And these systems implicitly assume that the key is close to the car, because otherwise they cannot communicate. So the idea is, if the key is far away, that the car, these devices will not see each other, they will not communicate, and nothing will happen. That's sort of the implicit assumption of this system. But that's exactly what in your relay attack you want to violate. Because what you can do as a relay attack, you can be in the middle, and you have to be with two persons, in fact. So one close to the key and one close to the car. And what you just do is just you relay, you just forward all the information from this key to the car and so on. So you touch the door handle, the car will send something, you forward it to this device, and this device will forward it to the key. The key will think, oh, the car is close by, I will have to respond. So it computes the response, and then you send this response back over here, and you send the response to the car. The car received this response, which will be correct because the key computed it. So the car will think, oh, I received the correct response. So it's indeed the key that's that talking to me. I will open the door and you can drive away. So that's a relay attack. And this is not such something that's been studied in theory or only for South African planes, but it's really something that happens in real life to steal cars. And some of you might already have seen this video, but if not, you can look it up on YouTube. So the British police, this is from 2017, as you can see, have published some video footage of really a relay attack, how this has been done. So if you look on, is this one that you can find on YouTube. So this car here is just in front of the door, but the key is somewhere close to the window, and then there are two attackers. You only see now one, but if you play the video, you will see that the second one will also appear. One stands close to the car, one close to the window, and they will steal the car. And so this happened in the UK, but also in the Netherlands and quite a lot of other countries. This is really now being used by criminals to steal cars. So if you have such a system, then it might be interesting to talk to your car dealer or so on to see what to do against this. So before I will dive into Wi-Fi security, just generally, if you look at wireless security, there are some problems which appear again and again. So there are some patterns you can see. One of them is that there are still some systems, you might not think that's not possible, but it's in practice it is, that are just not using any crypto at all, even in where you really wouldn't expect it. So one example there is that even here from this research group, even that we have discovered that, by example, pacemakers that communicate wirelessly to device programs, so on, that they don't use any crypto at all. And there are other examples as well in wireless systems that are quite security critical, where you don't have any crypto at all. Some systems you see that there is crypto, but very weak crypto. And an example there, but I'm very sure that Leonard will look at it on Friday. Oh no, he will not say no. But so another thing that has been done in this research group is, by example, hacking the Tesla authentication protocol. And that was an example of very weak crypto. So there was some crypto there, but it was so weak that it could easily be brute forced and circumvented. And often in the case of no crypto or weak crypto, you see also the third property, that the people designing this system, that they use proprietary protocols. And they wrongly think that, okay, because I'm using a proprietary protocol, nobody knows how my system works, so I'm safe, nobody will attack me. But then, of course, you can reverse engineer this protocol. You can have companies doing this, or as a researcher or as an attacker, you can do this yourself, learn how this system works, or maybe you just bribe somebody from the company, or steal some confidential information. You learn how the system works, and then if you are not using any crypto at all or just very weak crypto, yeah, then all security is gone. Another example, and that's something you will see later on in the Wi-Fi example, is that sometimes people are using crypto, but they're using it completely wrongly or incorrectly. And this can cause a lot of problems like protocol errors, or that there's only unilateral authentication and not mutual authentication, or it can easily downgrade the system. So this is also something you see once in a while in wireless systems. And then in general, people are sometimes making wrong trust assumptions, like assuming that the attacker has to be very close by to attack my system, or also, and that's the largest category of attacks, but that's one I will not discuss that much, are implementation errors, which can also cause a lot of problems. So this is long introduction, but now let's focus on one of the technologies. And I took Wi-Fi because yeah, everybody uses this. If you look at Wi-Fi, it's probably from, I think, 90s somewhere, you had the web protocol. So that was the sort of the first security that had been used in Wi-Fi. And then later on, as you will see in my presentation, this was replaced by WPA, WPA2, and now even very recently, WPA3. And so we'll look at all of these and see what happens. So let's start with the beginning, with the web. And how does web exactly work? If you look at how web encryption, how encryption exactly works in this system, it's very easy. So you have a certain message. What you do there in web is that you just add a CRC. And I think everybody knows probably a CRC. So that's just some linear code you compute to have some integrity checks. So you add the CRC, and then to encrypt this message, you use the RC4 stream cipher. And this RC4 stream cipher, it has a key, which is fixed, and then you have a random value, which is called the IV, which always changes per message you want to encrypt. And so combining these two, you sort of generate a key stream. And in a stream cipher, you just XOR these two. So you generate a stream cipher, which is different for every IV. You XOR it with your message, and that's it. That's the encryption. And then, of course, you also send the IV to the other party. The other party knows which IV they have to use to compute the same key stream to recover the message. So this is how web exactly works. But then if you look at web, I don't know if you still remember, but typically you had a sort of password or something, and the key is derived from this password. So you have a sort of fixed key typically in your access point in your Wi-Fi. So this key is in practice always the same. But then if you see that, so the only variable thing here that generates new key streams is this IV value. But this IV is only 24 bits in web. And so then you can do the math. And you can easily see that 24 bits is not enough. So if you then take the typical speeds you had at that time, and now it would even be much higher, but let's say you have a few megabits per second, then you would see that you would use all your IVs after about 10 hours of communication. After 10 hours, you really have used all IVs, and you for sure have to reuse an old one. In practice, because these IVs are generated randomly, you will have a collision much sooner. And so even after 10 seconds, it's rather likely that you already will have a collision and will use the same IV. And you can easily see if the same IV is being used because you send it here in the beginning of your message. And so what happens if you use the same IV? If you use the same IV, your key stream is the same. And if you use the same key stream, so you only have two messages which are encrypted with the same key stream. If you add the two ciphertexts, this key stream will cancel out and you have just the sum of the two plain texts. So you in fact break completely the encryption. So this is already an important problem in web, but there is much more. Also, authentication is not working properly. So let's first look at device authentication. So if you want to connect your device to the network, so or you don't use any security at all, and then of course there's nothing to break. But if you use security, so if you have this shared key using web, then it works very easy. It's just basically a challenge response protocol. So if you want to connect your laptop to your network, what happens is that your access point will send the nonce, and then the laptop will encrypt this nonce using web and send the encrypted value back to prove that it knows the key. And then if the access point will decrypt this, will check that indeed this was the nonce that this device that he sent. And if this is correct, then you're connected to the network. And so that's what's shown here as well. So you just have this challenge and you just encrypt it using this web encryption. And as I will show on the next slide, this can be very easily spoofed. So in fact, everybody can connect to a network. You don't have to know this key. even worse, you cannot only spoof this device application, you can spoof any message in web. And this is rather easy to see. So I already explained how you do you encrypt something. So you add the CRC, and then you add this key stream. And suppose we have a message, M, and we have this corresponding ciphertext, and we want to change this message, this ciphertext. We want to have the ciphertext of M prime, which is M plus a certain difference, delta. So how can we compute the ciphertext of this other message? It's very easy. You just have to add the difference and the CRC of this difference, and that's it. And you can do the math. And the reason why this works is because everything is linear. Your keystream is just adding something. Your CRC is also linear, so you just have all linear operations, and so this is very easy to just change some bits in the message, and then the same bits will change in the ciphertext, and for the CRC the same. So you can just compute the ciphertext of any message you want. If you just have one message and the ciphertext, you can compute the ciphertext of any message you want. And so you can apply the same trick over here. If you just have one nonce and the corresponding ciphertext, you can compute the encryption of any nonce. And so just by listening once to this communication, you can easily connect yourself, because if you get another nonce, you just compute the difference, you add this difference to the ciphertext, and you have your corresponding ciphertext you had to send to your access points. So if we sort of summarize this, what happens, what's wrong here? It's all, in fact, sort of the same underlying problem, is that they're using a stream cipher completely incorrectly. So they're using a stream cipher, but then in combination with LCRC, that doesn't provide any authentication. And also they're using a stream cipher, but it's a very small IV. And because of this, they're reusing key streams, and that's something you should never do if you're using a stream cipher, is reusing the same key stream. But so all of this is still independent of what stream cipher you're exactly using. This is just because they use it this primitive wrongly. But we even not at the end, there's even something more. So also the stream cipher itself that they're using is also not secure. So that in 2001, some researchers have discovered that there is some quite important security weaknesses in the key scheduling algorithm of this RC4 algorithm, exactly how it's being used in web. And so you can do all the attacks I explained on the previous slide, but you can even also attack the RC4 itself. And so the initial attack took about 39 minutes, that you had to capture some data, and then you had enough data to break the scheme. But later on, this has been optimized more and more, and now in practice it doesn't provide any security at all anymore. So that's something, if you only want to remember one thing of web, is that it really has no security. It might protect maybe against your grandmother who wants to hack into your network, but from the moment somebody knows a little bit of technical things, he or she can easily break all those things. It's really very, very low security. Of course, these people, when these flaws were discovered, they also note the vendors and the standardization organizations also noticed that, okay, we should really change something. And so that's why WPA came. But so there was sort of a fight going on. So it was very clear that whatever they were using here was not so good, so that web really was very bad from security point of view. But the vendors, they really didn't want to change their hardware. So they wanted to keep the hardware with this RC4 inside. And so in the end, they came up with a compromise in WPA. And what they did is basically that they introduced a new algorithm, TKIP. And what they basically do there is just a software solution. So they're still using the same hardware, still using RC4, but just doing some small software changes to avoid some of the attacks I explained on the previous slides. So they basically introduce a new algorithm. So instead of using a CRC, now they're using something else, which an algorithm which is called Michael, to do authentication. And they do also some tricks with the IV to avoid that you have this very frequent reuse of IVs of the same key stream. So they mix it with the key to avoid that you have this always the same IV and the same key again. And so these attacks avoid this attack of Shamir, by example, and also this device authentication problem, so with the CRC, but it's only marginally better. So it improves it a little bit, but still it's still very low security. But it was sort of a compromise to solve the issues of web while they were preparing for WPA2, which is a sort of major improvement of the security. And so indeed, later on, WPA came, and that was more long-term solution to really solve these security issues. And there they changed quite a lot the how security works. So they introduced AES, which is much better than using this RC4 algorithm. And they also introduced the concept of extensible authentication protocol, or short EAP. And I will explain a little bit later what this exactly is. And so basically, it's sort of a framework that they will introduce in WPA2, and it's all based on the 802.1x standard. And it basically works as this. So you set up a session, but then you sort of create a, I would call it a tunnel, or sort of you have some packets which you then send from one side to the other to set up the, to authenticate it, to set up a session key. And if you're just connecting to your access point at home, you will do this with this device. But if you are in an enterprise network and you have an authentication somewhere in your network, then this device will just forward everything to this authentication server, and you will do the authentication with this device. But so the thing you have to remember here is that you, instead of having one authentication method, it's just more a framework of doing authentication. And you have a lot of different variants of this EAP. This just defines how a frame looks like, but what you exactly do within this EAP, that's something you can configure. You can, by example, say, I want to use TLS, or I want to use certificates, or I want to use passwords, or you have a lot of different algorithms you can select there, but they are all, they're, whatever algorithm you use, they're sort of transported in these EAP messages. And then afterwards, you have your session key, and then you're authenticated. And so as I already mentioned, this 802.1x is not doing actual authentication, it's more defining how the packets look like, where inside of these packets you will do the exact actual authentication. And of course, you have to configure your access point for certain algorithms to support, and then of course also your client, your laptop, also has to support these algorithms. And so this is how it works, and this provides much better security. And so if I gave this presentation a few years ago, I would stop after this slide and say, okay, now everything is solved, and we have now WPA2, and luckily everything is fine. But there is a second part, you might have heard of this, and these are called the crack attacks. And so what people, even also from this university again, but from the computer science department, have discovered that there are still some issues in this 802.1x protocol. And what they particularly do is that they will zoom in on these EAP messages, and particularly on the handshake protocol. And so this was discovered by Matty van Hoof from the computer science department. So I borrowed some of his slides to explain the basic idea. So we have this tunnel here, and now let's zoom in a little bit exactly what happens here. In this, we want to set up a session key, and the first thing you do to set up the session key is to do this four-way handshake. You do this independently of what exact actual authentication algorithm or how you are going to derive the session keys. And so you have your client and your access point, and what happens is that there are four messages because it's a four-way handshake. And in this message, you always have a replay counter, which is not so important now. And in the beginning, you're sending a nonce from the access point to the client, and also from the client to the access point in the second message. And these two nonces are used to derive a session key. And then you have two other messages because you have four in total. So in this second message, you increase the replay counter and you exchange some other values. And then after the fourth message is being sent, so I now removing a lot of details which are not so important here. Of course, there are a lot of things in these messages, but not so important. But the thing to remember is that because of the standard defines after the fourth message, you should install the session key. So you derive it already earlier, but then here you really install it and you sort of reset encryption. And before I can explain what this reset encryption is, we first have to zoom in on what the encryption exactly is doing. And so also good to remember, so for a moment this session key is installed and this encryption is being reset, from that moment on, everything is ready to encrypt, and then everything else you send is always encrypted. That's how this is defined. So how does this encryption here exactly works? It's very easy. There are several algorithms, so I explained that now you can use AES, or you can still use this old TKIP algorithm. But so let's first look at the AES example. There are two algorithms which you can use, CCM or GCM, but both of them are authenticate encryption, but both of them, the encryption part is, again, a stream cipher mode. So you have a key, you have something which we call in crypto a nonce. These are not the same nonces as you saw in these first two measures. This is the encryption nonce, if I can call it like this. And this encryption nonce typically has some fixed values, like the header information and so on, but there's also a variable part, and that's in practice most of the cases a counter, which you just increase for a sort of packet number or sequence number, you increase for every packet. And this is a variable part, so you combine these two, you get a key stream, and then this key stream you just add to your message, and then you have your ciphertext. So this is very high level how such a stream cipher would work, the encryption part. And exactly the same would be true if you would use TKIP with RC4, it worked the same. So you again have sort of variable part, this nonce thing, you encrypt it, you get sort of a key stream, and you add it to your plain text to get your ciphertext. And so on this previous slide, if I say encrypt the traffic, that's exactly what happens there. And so you start doing this encryption. And so now when I say reset the encryption, this in practice means that you set this nonce that you had over here, this counter, you set it to zero. Because now you have installed your key, you're ready to encrypt, so let's set this counter to zero, and then you are ready to start encrypting the traffic. First message you use counter one, second message you use counter two, and so on and so on. So this is the handshake protocol, how it works, how it's been defined in 802.1x, beginning of the 2000s, and everybody was using this for a long time, everything was fine. And even better, there was even a formal security proof that this handshake protocol was secure. So people, it's not that they were just using it and say, okay, let's see what happens. No, there was even a security proof that this protocol was secure. However, a security proof is always taking a certain model. You prove some properties, and a thing that was not being included in this model was the concept of key reinstallation. So reinstalling a key. This is something that nobody ever looked at. And yeah, you can guess it already. This is exactly the root cause of this problem. That if you can do some tricks to reinstall a key, some things will go wrong. And these are the crack attacks. And in the next slides, I will very, very high level explain a bit what exactly goes wrong. So these crack attacks are implementation specific. So it's not a problem really in the standard itself. It's really more on the standard is very vaguely defined in this way on this particular topic. And so vendors sometimes implement it a bit differently. But most of them do some things that can be exploited to attack these implementations and cause some things to go wrong. So the 802.11, they published an official countermeasures after this paper appeared in 2017. But then next year, a follow-up paper came where they again broke the official countermeasure and even improved their attacks a bit more. But so now let's focus a little bit on what goes wrong. Again, I will omit a lot of details because, in fact, to do this properly, you really have to look a lot at details, but now that will bring us too far. So now I will just stay very high level and explain a bit the main idea. So you recognize this handshake here. And in fact, what you do in this handshake, the first two messages, you don't touch at all. But then from the third message on, the attacker will appear, and in this key reinstallation attacks, in the crack attacks, these are in fact man-in-the-middle attacks. So that's why you see now somebody here in the middle between the access point and the client. And how to exactly do this man-in-the-middle attack, I would refer to the paper there. They explain how they exactly achieve this thing, how they can be in the middle. So there are definitely in Wi-Fi some tricks you can do to be exactly in the middle of these two. And so what you do as an attacker is you let everything pass by, but then the fourth message from the client, when it goes back to the access point, you block it. But then, as you remember the handshake protocol, the client has sent the fourth message. So according to the state machine, according to the specification, the client will install the session key and set the AES nonce to zero. But then the authenticator never receives this fourth message. So after a while, it say, oh, I never received something, something went wrong. So it will resend message three with a new replay counter, because you are not going to send exactly the same message again. So you increase the replay counter now, so it's R plus two, but you send this back to the client. Oh, I never received message four. And now what will happen is that if you receive message three, the client is programmed such a way, if it receives message three, it will reply with message four. But now the special thing here is this thing. What happens, what was seen is that sort of in all specifications that the authors looked at, what's done, although it was not really specified in the standard, since there was already a session key over here, from this moment on, I said it, if there's a session key, you will start using it for any data you're sending. So in practice, this fourth message, since there's already a session key, was all vendors encrypt this already. So you encrypt this fourth message because there's already a session key, and you use, like I explained, you start using counter one as for your first message. So this is the first message you're encrypting. So this is nonce one that you're using. So let's just move everything a bit up. So you're now sending this fourth message. But then if we follow the state machine, after you're sending a fourth message, you have to install a session key. So on the right-hand side, everything happens as normal, so you install the session key and set the nonce to zero. But also on the left, this sending this fourth message again triggers an installation of the session key. And in this case, it will be a reinstallation of the session key because you already had it. But so this is exactly the flow you're abusing. So you reinstall the session key. And as I already mentioned, if you install the session key, or reinstall in this case, you set the nonce to zero. And so the first message afterwards you will send using nonce number one, counter number one. And now you might see the problem. I have two messages which are encrypted, and they using the same nonce, meaning that they are using the same key stream. And so I have two messages with the same with the same key stream, so I can recover the data that's being sent. So it's a nonce reuse. And so this is very high level how this exactly works, this attack. In practice, to do this, there are a lot of special tricks we can use to make sure that this fourth message, that indeed you first send this fourth message and then only reinstall in the session key, and you can abuse some other properties. And you can even extend this attack as well, that instead of having only one message being sent, that there are several messages being sent, and then only you re-trigger the reinstallation of the key. So you can apply this concept and get more data than just one message as well. But so this really shows the basic concept, that this key reinstallation, nobody ever thought of this, and this is because of the standard that is not so clear, you can exploit it. Just, I see that I'm almost at the end of my presentation, so very quickly, one slide about WPA3. So it's very recent, but good thing to remember about WPA3 is that WPA3 in general is not really new protocols, but it's just more a specification of which protocols you should use. So I mentioned this EAP thing. There are a lot of different options you can use. Here they really specify which ones you should use. Although there are some small things which are new, and one of them is transition mode. And this transition mode defines how you can combine WPA2 and WPA3. And one particular type that's being combined is this handshake protocol of WPA2. And in WPA3, something else which is called the Dragonfly protocol. It's not so important what it is now. But what, again, researchers have shown is that this combination of these two, in the design of this thing, how we should combine this, they made, again, some errors. And although WPA3 is just new and not really deployed yet, there are already some attacks that are discovered on this combination. Where you can do some downgrade attacks, or really some denial of service attacks, or really do a key recovery. So unfortunately, I don't have more time to explain this, but so I would refer you to this paper. I think it still has to be presented at the conference even, but it's already online, this Dragon Blood paper, where they explain the IDs. So this was Wi-Fi, but there are similar stories you can do about 2G, so about mobile networks. because I'm running out of time, I will just skip this, but you can check it in the slides. This is just a summary, or you can talk to me during breaks. I can explain it a little bit more. But it's a bit the same story. So in the initial versions of mobile networks like 2G, there were really a lot of security problems. And then in later versions, they fixed it more and more. Although it's still an active research area, so even in 5G, in the authenticated key agreement protocol, people have discovered some security issues. Similar story again for Bluetooth. Initial versions of Bluetooth had a lot of security problems, and in, again in the future versions, they solved most of these issues. So this brings me sort of to the end of the lecture. So good to remember is that you really have to consider these wireless security attacks, that you have to think that wireless range, by example, is not the same as for your normal devices, but can be much more, that it's important to use cryptography correctly, and that if you don't do this, that there can be a lot of security problems, and that in these wireless security standards or communication standards, that a lot of these standards were, the first versions were just like, let's design something and see what happens. Then there were a lot of security issues being discovered, and then they were gradually being solved in future versions. And if you are using this wireless security, it's always good to remember that you typically in security want to have a layered approach. So you typically want to go for end-to-end security, and you're not going to rely only on your wireless standard to secure everything. You're typically on application layer also going to apply encryption and authentication to have end-to-end security, that even though on the lower layer something would go wrong, that you still have your end-to-end security. And so this brings me to the end of the presentation. I don't know if there are questions now. I will be here around the entire day, so if later on you will think about something, feel free to ask.